is this, a leather shop? You gotta get your shoes done? Well, what is it? I know what size shoe you wear. It's an 8. What is this? Wayland, do you see what's on that wall? It's toys. Wayland, what have you done? What are you into now? Taking a Georgia girl to see all of this? What in the hell is it?
Eek!
Who was that masked man?
Yes, ma'am.
How are you, darling? What's your name?
Jim.
Jim, I'm shocked. What is this?
Head harness with a gag in it.
Oh, a gag.
Yes.
And swings and everything. Listen, I could get my whole Christmas thing here. The kids will just love these. I never forget one night I was with a guy. He reached in this box, pulled out a couple of chains, wrapped one chain around my right foot and one around my left. Then he jerked me upside down in front of a mirror. I said, dear God, if you're gonna treat me like this, I certainly don't want to watch. What is this one right here? Pin? This is a pin? Hello, America. This is a pin prick jewel case. Now you'll notice the family jewels can be kept to this. Ah! Oh my God, I saw a thing the other night. A kid in a bar, he was dressed up in leather. I turned around to him, he says, Madam, are you giving me a funny look? I said, sweetheart, you got a funny look, but I did not give it to you. I said, why do you wear all that leather? But I guess the chiffon is so hard to press. Well, Wayland, this must be for scuba divers. It's all made out of rubber. Now, hey, kid, you can have a lot of fun with these. Oh, look. Okay, everybody out in TV land, tell me your secrets!
Secrets.
With Wayland Flowers and Madame on the prowl.
Secrets.
With Dick Gregory, uninvited guest at the CIA.
Secrets.
A hidden computer beats Las Vegas for over $100,000.
Secrets.
Abby Hoffman and What's His New Face.
Secrets.
A midnight exchange in a church confessional.
Secrets.
With our special host, Robert Klein.
Strictly between you, me, and the lamppost, this program on secrets will examine secrets from the ridiculous to the sublime, which accounts, I guess, for my being here. Thoughtful and utterly baffled observer of the human parade that I am. Now, for people into secrets of the universe or the secrets of nature, sorry, you won't find any here. A secret as we see it is something deliberately withheld or hidden. I mean, just because we're not smart enough to understand dolphins doesn't mean they're keeping secrets from us. They're probably trying quite hard. Beep, 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 and we just don't understand beep, beep. In any case, secrets ain't what they used to be, thanks to Rona Barrett, to Deep Throat, and other strangers. Time was when a confessional was strictly a booth in church, till it became that lit-up box you're watching. Deep, dark, intimate things once revealed only at the pain of mortal sin, or the rack, or 90 cc's of sodium pentothal, are now confessed before 20 million viewers at breakfast. Good morning, America! Today's topic, a sad one, junkie brain surgeons. Stay tuned and meet one, the twitching gentleman on my right here. Then comes Donahue with a serious, in-depth discussion of our sexual confusions. Let's warmly welcome two folks who are starting a third gender. But letting cats out of bags has become even more than a national pastime. After the sadomasochists hang up their whips and salve their wounds, they go shopping for literary agents. Preferably the same one that helped the Watergate gang cash in on their crime and corruption with Zingo bestsellers. Creep and weep, sell and tell, spill and shill. Everybody seems to be doing it. Ex-maids and chauffeurs of the rich, ex-paramours and offspring of the famous. Keeping things under your hat may be a lost art, but Spilling the beans has created a whole new growth industry, and friends, we're part of it.
God, it'd be hard to keep a secret in here, wouldn't it? Whoops. How are you? Just brushing out? They say that only your hairdresser knows. I want to know what the hell they know.
Being a hairdresser, we have to be very careful about our secrets.
Personally, I think clients who confide in me really are not looking for a statement of validation in what they're telling me. They're just sitting here just running off at the mouth because they're sitting here for an hour and they just, most women love to talk. Women are, men for that matter, are very great gossips also, but they're not interested in what I have to say. All they're interested in what they have to say. They could care less, really, if I had any comment to make about who's sleeping with who. Well, I have a very varied clientele. People from all walks of life. Gorgeous call girls who only go with people who can really afford them. Boys for hire, prostitutes. And, you know, they're my clients, and so I say, well, gee, what's new this week? They say a new car or a new coat, or I'm going to be chartering a flight. Do you remember the time I was telling you about this woman who came in here? We were talking about divorcees and what happens when you get divorced at 42, 45. I told you this woman came in here, and she told me her girlfriend and her had to sleep with this man on the pool table. The three of them had to go to sleep on this pool table together because the other gal wouldn't leave. Nothing surprises me anymore. Like, for instance, the day that I was doing this fantastic makeup on this very gorgeous, exotic creature. And then when we finished our makeup, I asked my client to step out of the chair and look at the makeup. Well, this person stepped out of the chair and just stepped out the way a man would step out of the chair. And only then did I realize that I had done a transsexual. Money, sex, who's sleeping with who is paying for whose clothes, and who's getting what from who and why and how, and just power, sex, money. Because if you have power, you can get anybody you want. If you have money, you can get anybody you want, and sex is, of course, just thrown in.
Oh, whips and chains. How are you, darling?
All right.
Have you got a lot of that boot? Turn that boot around. Let's see that spur. Now, you must have a secret. What is that for?
I tell you later.
All right. I'll be in the cowboy hat in the back.
Okay.
When Keith Taft of Sunnyvale, California, puts on his glasses, he sees a row of tiny, color-coded lights set in the rim, blinking. Here is the stuff private American dreams are made of. Keith Taft, an engineer, the image of straight-arrow Baptist decency, is devoted to his wife, family, church choir, and the making of clandestine gambling computers. Secret but perfectly legal little devices designed to beat a virtually unbeatable system at its own game, namely blackjack. For well over $100,000 that he'll admit to.
The electronic computer can make 200,000 calculations in a second, so it knows exactly which cards have been played and which cards are in my hand and which cards are in the dealer's hand. The computer is restrained by your everyday ace bandage. The power is supplied for this computer by one of these battery packs, which will provide enough energy for an hour and a half. The input to the computer is done via the toes. There are four toe switches. The output is seven little tiny colored lights located in the upper rim of these standard glasses. And these lights would give me the information I needed from the computer to tell me how much to bet. Starting with the input from the toes, the wires coming up to the base of the computer. The computer digests the information and then gives a decision as to how to play the game and how much to bet. And that signal is sent up these wires to the lights in the upper part of my glasses, which I can see. And this was the concept I conceived to play blackjack in the state of Nevada.
The The Taft suburban San Francisco home is a five-hour drive from Nevada, where Keith once bet his first quarter and had a great notion.
They know that the odds are against them. That's why those casinos have all those bright lights, neon signs. But I was in Reno with my family, and we were vacationing, and we were observing the slot machines, and I became intrigued. And when we returned to Sunnyvale after that vacation, I checked out a bunch of books in the library and ran into one in particular, Edward Thorpe's Beat the Dealer. And as I sat reading that, I thought, say, I bet I could use my knowledge to build a computer that would allow me to play a nearly perfect game and greatly enhance my odds. I would come home from work and go to it and start soldering. There are over 2,000 tiny solder joints in this computer. And till the wee hours of the morning, and get up and go to work early, repeat it 7 days a week.
This really put a strain on our family because of the tremendous hours that Keith spent developing this and away from home. And of course, we had four teenagers at the time. So I think I felt the strain. Also, it was difficult because we're very involved in our church work and sing in the choir and other activities in the church. Keith leads singing. And I always had to make excuses where he was. And this became a problem for me. I think one of my fears was that he could possibly become a compulsive gambler.
I played, in fact, 2 days a week for 12 virtually consecutive weekends. And the results, $500. And I won the next weekend, and I won the next weekend, and I won the next weekend, and I said, hey, I got it. So I'd had such a good track record with it, I thought now is the time to make some money. So instead of betting from $5 to $15 on each hand, I upped that from $50 to $150 on each hand.
I was a thorn in his side.
To give it up many times along the way. But to do something, to be the first to do something, I recognize this is a new frontier. And in fact, to do something that would give me independence, which I greatly cherish, it's the Walter Mitty dream.
Taft has since devised far more sophisticated blackjack computers than this early prototype that he agreed to demonstrate for us in actual blackjack play.
Shake five now.
Roll five. As far as system shake players five. Go, there are those that what you call card counters, for instance, in your 21 games. They're caught in hand by management.
I'll select a table in which the dealer deals down to the last few cards, if possible. Because that's where the advantage is greatest with the
wired,
computer.
Wired, head to toe, Keith arrives with Dorothy at a leading Western casino, unannounced and entirely unsuspected.
Okay, the number one thing that we watch in our business is money. We keep a strict eye on any possible means people have at their disposal to, you know, take advantage of the game, to alter the percentages of the game.
You're both won.
Nice.
But I've seen people that I was sure were counting, because they were just not even talking. You could hear their brains just whirling. Going this.
Do you always work that shift to get used to it?
While we spoke with pit bosses and security men, Keith sits under their noses at a nearby table, betting away like any tourist.
Ooh, you have a pretty punk card.
There are electronic devices where an individual can compute this and that and everything, but we don't give that much credibility at all.
Oh, yes. When you're hot, right? You never know, but you've seen that pretty good higher. Got an ace. I just need a big 10 to go with it.
That was mine, I guess.
A big 10. Oh, and there's two more aces in this, and there's all four aces coming. Crazy cards. Just never know.
There have been times when we have found people with these devices, and I am familiar with them. I have seen them. and our employees are trained to watch for certain things.
Look at that. She got one down there. Big one, big picture. Oh. Got it. Nice. We had two out there, $10 a piece, just $120. How's that feel?
Good.
Counties are not all that hard to spot. Our means of surveillance have become so sophisticated in the past years that it's not the problem that it used to be in the past years.
Nice to win, huh?
For just an hour's play betting $5 chips, Taft's electronic genie won him $205. A little simple arithmetic would show the outcome had he bet $100 chips, his usual stakes.
Dana took a picture of $40,000 or $50,000 in hand.
That's right.
We all took turns taking and picking that up. That was the most amount I'd ever seen in cash. Never thought money like that could even exist in cash.
And you never. In Reno, 1977. Taft's sons were discovered gambling with Dad's blackjack computer and arrested. Authorities ruled, however, that they had done nothing illegal. And the boys came home over $40,000 richer.
They jam, you know.
Subway station and a cockroach bed? Are you in the High Time, Yipcha Times? In the East Village, West Village? In America, Africa? Maybe you're on the moon. Where are you, Abby Hoffman?
Hollywood.
The FBI can't find you because
they're... There's a cocaine charge over his head, which carries 25 years in jail. And we want to make sure that he's not arrested. He wants to come in and come to the underground voluntarily and not to be picked up by police.
Abby! Where are you? Abby! Where's Abby Hoffman?
We have a grandmother who's 95 years old, whose brother was like a Bolshevik in the Russian Revolution, and she's living on till Abby's a free boy.
He wants to be politically active on the level that he was before, but he can't do that, and that's the main reason why he wants to come above ground.
Did
he
you
wants
see
to be
that
himself.
Poster? Did you see that poster there?
Yeah.
Abby gave us the idea for the poster.
Abby Hoffman pointed out that there's a difference between being surveilled and being hunted. When you're surveilled, your phone is tapped, they watch you, they follow you, so you always know
that they know.
That they know. But when you're being hunted, it's a different story altogether.
You got him to be busted for cocaine. America, you are insane.
I've known him 20 years, and in that time, I've watched him, for example, end the House Un-American Activities Committee by burlesquing it, posing as a Vietnamese guerrilla in front of the committee.
Bring Abby home, YIP!
I've watched him in Mississippi, in McComb, Mississippi, try to get blacks the right to vote.
Bring Abby home!
I watched him bring humor into a social movement.
Are you Abby Hoffman?
Do you have any clues at all? Did the department pass down any paper on him?
Not that I know of.
Theoretical photos, artist sketches, reconstructions
not
of his face?
We know nothing about Abby.
Yes, I've seen plastic surgery on people that have been burned and stuff, and unfortunately, they don't come back to their original appearance.
But do you think Abby Hoffman could be so changed physically?
Sure.
That you wouldn't detect him?
Surely.
Are you Abby Hoffman?
Are you serious? Do I look like Harry Hoffman?
No, I'm not.
He had plastic surgery.
No, I'm not. I'm not Abby Hoffman. He may be Jewish, but he doesn't wear one of these.
I think it's possible that he get into somebody, you know, he pretends to be somebody. It might be me, but I wouldn't know.
Does
this do it? Is everyone else not sure I'm not Abby Hoffman?
Are you Abby Hoffman?
Am I? Why should I be? I don't even know her.
Excuse me.
Let's speak to you later.
Excuse me, sir. Are you Abby Hoffman? You look like you know something. Are you Abby Hoffman? Are you Abby Hoffman?
Unfortunately, I am.
do they have the faintest suspicion that you are a man who has been surgerized, plasticized, and bionically recreated?
They do not. And this media coverage isn't helping my underground efforts.
I think that anybody who came of age during a certain period, probably in the 60s, is in some degree, to some degree, Abby Hoffman.
Are you Abby Hoffman, really?
No, I'm not.
You're not. Are you, sir?
Nah. Hoffman? What do you mean Hoffman?
Are you Abby Hoffman, sir? Are you Abby Hoffman?
I've been underground a little less time.
As broke as I am, I wouldn't want to be anybody right now.
Excuse me, sir.
What?
Excuse me, sir. Are you Abby Hoffman behind that mask?
Listen, I don't speak English.
Excuse me. Excuse me.
Thank you very much. Whee! I just want to find out something. Oh! I want to know something. Is it true that alligators live down there? I've heard all my life that kids, they bring alligators back from Florida and then they stick them down the toilet.
Where is Jolie?
Hey, Jolie! Get over here!
Wonderful.
How are you, Jolie?
Wonderful, thank you. And you?
I went to a Hollywood party the other night. Everybody was there except Rona Barrett. I don't know why she didn't make it. Lord knows she'd go to the opening of an envelope. What's happening with Zsa Zsa? How many times was she married?
Only seven times.
Only seven?
You know, it's not so easy to find immediately the right one. This is also my third husband. And we can afford to change the husbands because we are rich. How much you was married?
How many times?
Yes.
Oh, I was never married. I did live with a guy once for about 20 years to see if it'd work out.
It didn't work out?
It worked out once. But I worked it back in. Now, listen. I've been thinking about taking a nip and a tuck here.
All my friends, included myself, I had also two facelifts, and it works very good.
Yes, I have a 17-year-old boyfriend. My girlfriend doesn't like it. She says, Madam, you should be ashamed of yourself. Dating that young kid, it could be dangerous, could be fatal. I said, oh, what the hell, Maud? If he dies, he dies.
Now, tell me, just between you and me.
But you want to know again?
How old are you?
I will not tell you.
Ask me how old
because
I am.
Because when I tell you, I lie, and I don't like to lie, so...
Here's a document from J. Edgar Hoover to the Chicago office pertaining to me, dated May the 15th, 1968. It says right here, from the director, and then it has Hoover's serial number on it. And it reads, to the Chicago office concerning Richard Claxton Gregory, concerning a speech by Gregory on April the 28th, 1968, where he noted that syndicate hoods are living all over. They are the filthiest snakes that exist on this earth. I did say that, yeah. Then Hoover says this, second paragraph, consider the use of this statement in developing counterintelligence operation to alert La Costa Nostra to Dick Gregory's attack on them. What this amounts to, Hoover is saying to the Chicago office, get in touch with the mafia and tell them that Dick Gregory's calling them snakes, so they'll kill Dick Gregory. Now, how I came by this document goes to the Freedom of Information Act, and a newspaper reporter in Chicago, Bob Warden, he got it, and he called me, and he was just dumbfounded.
Dick, last summer, we were in Washington looking at the Freedom of Information Act and making a few visits to government agencies. We got to the FBI, and of course, the only question in our mind was, how would we be greeted?
They had expected you there.
Remember, right.
But they hadn't expected me.
And as I understand, this is the first time you ever set foot in the FBI
building?
FBI building.
I've been in front of it with a picket sign.
Right.
Never had no need for wanting to go inside the FBI.
And you ranked high on the list of people that they knew intimately.
And wanted to kill.
You're talking about the documents?
Yes.
Okay.
I didn't think I would get in. I thought I'd run across a lot of hostility.
The PR man, that stocky guy with a mustache, greeted you, blinked, we went right on in into the file room, where they had 11 million files on individual Americans.
God bless you. Thought y'all was on vacation. Caught myself slipping in here. Feel a little bit better now, I see y'all.
I can assure you, first of all, that the Freedom of Information Act is alive and well, and we've had a great deal of experience with the act, as I'm sure that you've read many times in the paper. Basically, the act itself allows any person to seek access to records maintained by the government. There's no restriction on that.
Why don't the FBI destroy the files that would have information that's embarrassing to them? What's the answer?
We try to strike the balance that we can to preserve the historical records pursuant to the guidelines by the archivists, as well as honoring the privacy considerations as guaranteed by the Privacy Act.
He gave you pretty much the new image that they're trying to establish with the FBI.
Yes.
And on the face of it, your attitude was, as a guest in his establishment, you seem to feel that this, in fact, was so.
I would say that it's left up to the American people to find out how in-depth that change will be. I took this guy as being sincere. Now, can you get this house back in order by just wanting the FBI to be good? Mm-hmm. Or is it left up to people outside of that agency and Congress and the Senate to see to it that you have the type of legislation someone will be responsible?
We cannot release information which would...
We were walking past the files of the Rosenbergs, the Hiss case, Whitaker Chambers, some of the most volatile trials and cases in American history. We went past one after the other.
You didn't see his mafia syndicate's names, did you?
One day, if you don't have time, come to my farm. I have files on all of you.
We probably walked past the G's, that's for sure.
Yep.
Why didn't you ever ask or take out of your briefcase the files that you had and asked if there were any more like these, where this came from?
Because one, I thought it would be unethical if I pulled out my files. I didn't want to open up myself to be exposed to tampering. You see, I was still conscious. I was in the FBI building. And that some funny things probably could happen. And two, I didn't come in there to embarrass. There's few agents that I would eat around, you know. But this man here, I just felt very comfortable with him, and I felt kind of sad and kind of sorry that, you know, the agent still represents that aura that's going to have to be changed around, and it's not going to be changed around.
So you made a distinction between him as an individual and the institution that he represented.
Yes, I don't think the institution is clean.
FBI today is one of the most vibrant outfits, government agencies have ever.
Now, Dick, there is historic little moment to me. The man who was on the top 20 of Nixon's list and probably somewhere in the top 10 of J. Edgar's list, July 1978.
I'm glad you joined us today.
Thank you, brother.
And here it is. Freeze that frame. I mean, did you ever think that you would see the day when you would be exchanging a Black Power handshake,
right? That's right.
With the deputy director of the files section of the FBI.
Plus, I got his watch.
We tried to get into the CIA in the normal way. As producer, I sent the letter, and we were turned down in no uncertain terms. No cameras. We made two appeals by phone, got nowhere. Visited the FBI, and then decided to get out of all that traffic, go to the country, and where did we end up?
Thank you. got tied up in traffic, and we went all kind of ways. We saw the CIA sign, and then we missed it, and we went around the back way and then the front way, and we were about to give up.
Right.
And there...
And all of a sudden...
The CIA.
To get into the CIA is tantamount probably to getting into Fort Knox.
Probably more security, officer. Okay. Fort Knox has never killed nobody or spied on no one. Fort Knox is just the money. If it's there, it's probably the Chase Manhattan Bank.
Now, to get into the CIA with cameras would mean that every member of our crew would have had to go through an exhaustive clearance.
Right.
To get in with cameras, tape recorders, and their arch enemy. But here we are now.
Right, at a guard post, and this is a message you gave me.
With the name of the public relations man that I had been involved with on the telephone.
That had told you no.
In no uncertain terms. However, instead of their picking up the phone to call him.
Hey, babe. How you feel? Fine. God bless. How's everything? Fine. Peace and love, too. Yeah. God bless. How's everything? Good. Hey. Okay. Thank you, babe.
They said here's a pass, the VIP pass, with special parking privileges.
Okay, thanks much.
The implications of what we had done didn't register. I was kind of holding my breath, waiting to see where they were going to come at us from.
I kept waiting to see the trench coats.
If we were KGB agents in that car, could they have gotten in that easily?
No, because the KGB is not as pure as we are. It's not as clean, it's not as honest, not as ethical. The same way the CIA couldn't get into KGB headquarters, but we probably could. No, not at all. And remember, we didn't go there with malice.
No, we didn't.
We were going there to ask the question, is why will we not be permitted to come on and talk about the Freedom of Information Act?
Now, our cameraman kept shooting from the hip without his eye to the eyepiece.
I think you were scared. So here we are.
I was.
In the mouth of the line. Mm. And let's look at the tonsils.
Okay, sir. Would you sign in, please?
That's when I put my expression on my face. I was coming to do day work, any laundry that had to be picked up.
Are you gentlemen all going in, or what are you?
Yeah. Did you keep my ID going?
Okay. Someone can sign in here.
That's her job. If you floated down here from outer space, if you was from Mars and walked in there, it's not a matter of a fact that some Martians have just walked in and gonna take you back with us. She said, before you do anything, feel this out, right?
All of a sudden, we are now finding ourselves with two plainclothes CIA men and another guy whose face was the color of this aluminum plate.
Right.
It was stone cold lead.
Yes.
Well, here's our security man right here, and he can explain to you as well as anything what the problems are, you know, with photographing inside.
Yeah. But,
well, our problem, of course, is that we got security problems, you know, there are people here that are undercover. And it requires all kinds of people, you know, standing right there, making sure that, you know, pictures aren't taken with people on it, and, you know, it really is rough.
And he said, what in the, how, no, he said,
how
did you get in here? That's all they wanted to know.
We were at a standstill. We were stuck.
And finally, we became unstuck because there were two federal police cars waiting for us.
To take us out.
To escort us out of the property.
Out of the place.
And they asked whether there was any film in the camera.
And I looked away.
Yes.
Someone said, there's no film.
I heard something to that effect.
And we get this whole rap about, well, you can't have cameras here, you can't take pictures here. Why? Because these are real spies. Well, I make a deal with you. You give me my pictures, I'll give you yours.
They would release my files. I would be very, very happy.
Mm-hmm.
Except October the 3rd of 47. They could keep that one. They could keep that one. I cheated on a math test in grade school, and I know they got it.
The exact date, I don't know anymore, but it was April 42, till the Gestapo came in August 44, something like that. We ourselves didn't talk about it. And how it came out, I don't know. When you passed at the last staircase, then you came on a landing, and there was a bookcase. We made it to hide the door for upstairs. And then on the top, there was also the door that we opened, and then we were in the room of the Franks. 2 years is quite a long time to live up there, not allowed to go down, talk with people. That must have been a very, very difficult time for them, especially for the child Anne, who was a vivid, vivid person.
Friday, 21 July 1944. Dear Kitty, now I'm really getting hopeful. Super news. An attempt has been made on Hitler's life, and not even by Jewish communists or English capitalists, but by a proud German general, a count and quite young. The Führer was saved by divine providence. Unfortunately, he got away with just a few scratches. Still, I don't want to anticipate the glorious events too soon, but the prospect that I may be sitting on school benches next October makes me far too cheerful to be logical.
It was on a day. Which day exactly, I don't know. One German in uniform, Gestapo, and two other that came and asked for the boss. No, that I am. I said, show us the house. And they knocked on every door, and also they went with a bayonet through. Now when they came, they knew exactly about the bookcase in front of that door. One of them went with his hand behind and opened the door. And I had to go upstairs. When I was there and had came in the room, Mrs. Frank was the first one who I saw, and I said to her, the Gestapo is here. Anne and her sister, they were standing behind her mother. They were quiet, didn't say anything. There was nothing to say for them. They didn't even cry. And I had also to bring up the other persons. They got a little bit time to pack their stuff, what they were allowed to take with them. It was not so much. And then we had to go off down. We had to go down. In the meantime, a truck was coming, be the auditor to step in that truck and brought to the Gestapo headquarters in Amsterdam. Became in different cells. And that was the last time I saw the people.
Could you?
Yeah?
Could you tell me your own feelings in those last hours?
My own feelings, I suppressed them because I knew it wouldn't help anything. And I looked in the world with dead eyes.
Mark, do you know what time it is? In the morning. Come back in the morning.
For the love of God, man. Father, I beg you now. It can't wait.
All right. All right, go. Go to the booth. I'll be there.
To be Father, for I have sinned.
Lord, be in thy heart and on thy lips, that thou mayest faithfully and humbly confess all thy sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
come in one time and tell me he just killed his wife and his child, and he did. And that's a fact, and it happened to me about 7 years ago.
Gentleman comes in about 1:30 in the morning, he's had a few, and he says to me, I just had the best night with a lady that tied me up for 4 hours and beat my ass. And I just went, okay.
People tell you things like they're having a lot of problems with their old lady, or they're about to be sued. I mean, upon the first couple of drinks, a lot of people I've never seen before in my life. I like it. Sometimes it's a pain in the ass. Sometimes it's a drag.
Why is it a drag?
It's demanding sometimes. You know, I feel like if it's a friend, okay. If it's somebody I've never seen before, I'm a sensitive person. But
you want to tell me about their wife breaking up with their wife? They don't want to do their children. They don't know what they're gonna do. I listen. You just listen. You know, sometimes you feel a guy wants to talk. You stay there and you talk to him for as long as he wants. You know, sometimes you can advise people want to be by themselves. Just leave them by yourself. You know, that's part of the job. I mean, anybody can pour a drink. You get a robot back here, pour a drink.
I'm pretty tight about things. Whatever anybody says to me is strictest confidence as you like. No, I mean that, really, you know, because usually it's baloney to begin with, and I wouldn't dare repeat it. It's hogwash for the most part, but every once in a while somebody will come up with something that is revealing.
Yoo-hoo!
Hi,
girl.
How are you? You want to be on television?
I want to go out.
You what?
I want to go out.
Do you keep any secrets?
Yes. Watch for the
party. You mean you'll keep a secret for money?
Yes.
Well, what kind of guys come by here? I mean, in big cars or?
Big car, all kinds of cars.
Well, what do they want, the ones in the big cars?
$10. No, they don't
really
want to spend no money.
They don't want to spend the money?
It's the little cars that want to spend the money.
You have a lot of dates?
Sure.
How many do you have a night?
Mucho.
Mucho?
About 100.
100 a night? You couldn't do 100 a night?
Why not? I'm gorgeous.
Well, you couldn't. Well, isn't that a lot?
Very, very good.
Well, and fast. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, listen, you do all kinds of work, huh?
Yeah.
Got a 9-to-5 job?
Oh, I used to. Sure.
Yeah, I did too. That's if I couldn't get 9, I'd take 5.
Any consideration of author J.D. Salinger has to end as a view of the whole, not the donut. Recently turned 60, Salinger fled from fame into the New Hampshire hills almost a quarter century ago. He's published nothing in 13 years, forbids interviews, bans the use of his photo on book jackets. Hollywood has given up waving million-dollar offers. But Salinger hasn't succeeded yet at making himself a nobody. 15 million copies in 63 editions later, his Catcher in the Rye continues to win new audiences. And so our speculation begins in its pages.
I've assigned Catcher in the Rye to several generations of students, and I'm always a little amazed at the ability of each new class to somehow make it seem relevant to their own lives. We spent a lot of time speculating, those young people and I, about the extent to which Holden's adventures reflect J.D. Salinger's perceptions of what life is all about. We keep coming back to a scene in Ernie's bar. Holden is observing old Ernie stinking it up before a crowd of prep school jerks and college jerks. He listens to the show-offy ripples and the high notes and a lot of other very tricky stuff. And when the bar goes wild at the finish, his reaction may tell us something about the author who created him. As the cheers and applause for Ernie's performance resound, Holden sees the scene in another way.
I swear to God, if I were a piano player, or an actor or something, and all those dopes thought I was terrific, I'd hate it. I wouldn't even want them to clap for me. People always clap for the wrong things. If I were a piano player, I'd play it in the goddamn closet.
He seemed like a very lonely person. He didn't have any close friends.
Every other word he said was like, it depressed me and things like that. Maybe it is
Salinger's mm-hmm. own experiences.
Maybe it's like a secret autobiography or something. You know? Because nobody knows anything about him, so why he could do that real secret and not let anybody know it was about him.
What does JD stand for, anyway?
I think he's dead.
Nobody ever sees him. Maybe he's just dead and they're all hiding it. Maybe he's has a fortune and his servants are living high off the hog.
J.D. Salinger's secluded chalet sits somewhere on a hilltop, off one of the lovely unmarked roads that wind through the 36 square miles of Cornish, New Hampshire and the bordering Woodstock, Vermont, where local residents don't believe in wasting words.
Does the name J.D. Salinger mean anything to you?
Yes.
What does it mean?
He's a writer.
He's a writer. Where does he live?
New York.
You don't see him very often. I don't know as I've ever seen him.
Does the name J.D. Salinger mean anything to you?
No.
I've only seen him once in my life.
Really? Got a question.
Yes, sir.
Curious. There's a guy around here by the name of J.D. Salinger. Name mean anything to you?
No, sir.
He comes into the store. I've seen him probably once, twice a year. And he buys like anybody else. I've seen him use credit cards in here. And he buys filing cabinets, this sort of thing. We have delivered merchandise to his home in Cornish.
How about what other supplies?
The normal writing-type supplies, paper, this sort of thing.
We know where he lives, and I would expect that if he wanted to see people, he'd announce it. And to my knowledge, he's not done this. I think he likes his privacy, and...
He's a very private person. He doesn't like being talked about, or to.
Yeah, he ran upside the pickup there, and we just stopped for about 15 seconds. And seemed like a real pleasant person. That's the only time I ever met him.
He's not one of these that will snub you or anything like that. He'll wave and make himself known, but then he goes right along.
I don't understand his writing, so it doesn't mean that much.
I went over and asked Mr. I spoke to Mr. Salinger, and I said, can we take your picture? And he said, no, very roughly, no.
Maybe Salinger is, like, writing all these books, and he doesn't want them publicized right yet because he doesn't want to be, like, around when they get published, because he doesn't want to be, like, around people that want to make him famous. He just wants to be alone by himself. And
like a lot of people, they kind of get worn out. They're built up so much and so talked about, and then they just fade out.
Wrote Catcher in the Rye, and say he writes another book. Maybe he doesn't want nobody like to compare it with Catcher in the Rye.
I think if you have a talent, then you should share it with other people. I mean, this world has had it already. It needs a lot. Maybe he doesn't think that he's good enough for other people to read him.
Even matter, he thinks he's too good.
Yeah, too good, maybe.
And he doesn't think that other people can understand what he writes.
Maybe Salinger is writing a big novel, and it's just taking him a long time to write it, and he's going to publish it when it's all done.
True.
Nobody knows.
Well, maybe.
Knowing his capacity to write, I expect he's doing something that's productive. This is only a supposition on my part. And I suspect he's playing his cards pretty close to his chest in the whole matter.
I read an article in the Village Voice, I think, saying that he was writing. He is quoted as saying that he was writing, but not for publication, which I find rather hard to believe.
What do you find hard to believe about that?
Well, that anyone would bother writing unless you were writing to be read.
Now, we're not interested in his private life. We're interested in knowing why the great writer has stopped writing.
Then you'd have to ask a great writer.
I wouldn't walk up there with a cameraman and all that.
If a tree falls in these woods with no one as a witness, can we say it actually fell? If Salinger has, in fact, been writing works he refuses to publish, as far as his public is concerned, do they exist? Salinger's right to privacy, of course, inalienable. But the right to deny his work to an audience he created, question. After all, this world can use any beauty and truth it can get these days. So we can't help but wonder about something Holden said 27 long years ago.
people always clap for the wrong things. If I were a piano player, I'd play it in the goddamn closet.
Someone once said that secrets like money can't be enjoyed until they're spent, or at least traded. You know, like back in the second grade, come on, I'll show you mine if you show me your... Of course, I was never into that dirty kid stuff myself. I never peek into other people's medicine cabinets either. And so, as with most things, we try to have our cake and eat it, fighting the invasion of our privacy by a silent legion of computers and electronic snoops, while indulging in a national media binge of scandal and gossip mongering and letting it all hang out. Say, listen. Any of you emperors watching, beware of kids who say you're wearing no clothes. They spell trouble, pal.
Do you know what a secret is?
Yes. Yes.
You do?
Yes.
What is it?
Something when someone tells you something and you can't tell no one else.
Who do you tell secrets to most?
My best friends.
Your best friends?
Yeah. People who can keep secrets.
Well, who told you a secret last?
My sister.
Your sister? What was it?
I can't tell you.
Why not? I'm not going to tell your sister. I don't even know her.
It's a secret. How come if you're just a puppet, you know so much about secrets?
Well, we have secrets too, you know.
Really?
Secrets is made possible in part by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.